On the evening of 3rd September 1939, the very day that Neville Chamberlain announced that a state of war existed between Germany and Great Britain, the passenger ship SS Athenia suffered a devastating explosion on her port side. She had been attacked by the German submarine U-30. The German Navy had fired the first shot in the Battle of the Atlantic, and Britain and her allies were at war with the U-boat. The vast battlefield was to be the site of the longest continual battle of the Second World War. The conflict was not simply a duel between ships and submarines. Aircraft were also to play a vital role. The battle was to enter a new tactical arena, initiate huge technical advances, and redefine the rules of naval warfare. As an island nation, Great Britain had always relied on merchant shipping for trade and supplies, a fact that her enemies had long recognized. It was no different in 1939, and merchant ships bound for British ports became targets for the U-boats. Germany's aim was to devastate British supply routes in order to bring Britain to her knees. Germany's clandestine U-boat building program, in direct contravention of the Treaty of Versailles, had given Admiral Karl Dönitz, chief of the German submarine force, a fleet of some 57 vessels at the outbreak of war. While not sufficient to mount a wide-ranging attack, it was more than adequate to inflict significant losses on British merchant shipping in the early stages of the war. A clever tactician, Dönitz constantly developed his strategy to maximize his small forces' operational effectiveness. As more U-boats came out of the yards, Dönitz was able to expand his field of operations and range far further than British coastal waters.
Submarines are by nature lone hunters, and initially Dönitz used them to act independently in areas where Allied shipping was bound to turn up. In the early stages of the war, these tended to be the western approaches to the United Kingdom or in the North Sea. As Allied responses became more successful and as more U-boats became available, Dönitz moved them further west and deeper into the Atlantic. After the fall of France, when the ports of the French Atlantic coast became available, he pushed this boundary much further west. By that stage, U-boats could operate almost to the North American coastline. When the United States entered the war, submarines were deployed as far south as the Caribbean, with notable success. But to remain effective for long periods, U-boats operating in these distant waters had to be resupplied regularly. Initially, this was achieved by the use of disguised merchant ships. Thanks to good intelligence, the Allies soon located and destroyed these hidden enemies. Dönitz then had to turn to the Milchkau supply submarines for replenishing supplies. Dönitz claimed that the tactic of the wolf pack was his own invention, but in fact such methods had been used to attack Allied shipping in the First World War. However, Dönitz developed the concept much further, especially when he was able to deploy over 40 U-boats into the Atlantic at any one time. In practice, this meant intelligence sources would identify a convoy of Allied merchant ships and its track could be assessed. Dönitz would then order as many U-boats as practical to lie in its path. This could be as many as 12 submarines, or even more. This force, or wolf pack, would be given a code name and a commander would be chosen. If the plan worked, as it did on many occasions, then the convoy would be attacked as it entered the area, with the sheer number of U-boats overwhelming the escorts. U-boats proved most effective when attacking at night. During daylight, they shadowed the convoy on the surface. As darkness descended, the submarine would submerge and find a suitable position for the attack. Braver commanders would go within the convoy itself. Ideally, a commander would find a position from which a salvo of torpedoes could be launched at a cluster of targets. Should one of the salvo miss its first target, there would be a reasonable chance that it would hit a second or even third. This firing solution was very hard to create, and usually a commander would have to be content with firing at one target, then changing position before the escort could react. He might have time to launch a second spread at another target or part of the convoy. Using these techniques, a U-boat could hit two or three targets before the attack had to be abandoned. In effect, the Germans simply used their U-boats as torpedo boats, which could only submerge for short periods. The main objective of the Allies in the Battle of the Atlantic was to get merchant ships into British ports unscathed. If merchant ships were to sail alone, they would be easy prey for German submarines. Even if ships were armed, they would be able to do little against a torpedo attack from a submerged U-boat. The only ships that could sail alone were the large passenger liners like the two Cunard Queens, which relied on their speed for protection. Other merchant ships were grouped together into a convoy. A convoy could consist of 60 ships, although most were about 40 strong. They were either fast at about 15 knots or slow at perhaps 10 knots. Convoys were identified by a code that was based on their destination or origin. For example, in the early days, OA coded convoys sailed from the south coast ports, OB from Liverpool, OG convoys went to Gibraltar. Later, the coding system was changed to make life more difficult for the Germans and to reflect the much more complex pattern of convoy use. Ideally, convoys would be escorted, but such was the shortage of escorts at the start of the war that most convoys could only be given naval protection as far as 12 degrees west. Before and after that line, they were on their own. Even if they did have an escort, it would probably be an armed merchant cruiser, plus perhaps one or two destroyers or trawlers. As more escorts became available, the limit of protection was moved further west until it reached the North American coastline. By late 1941, a convoy could expect to have perhaps four or even six escort vessels. By 1943, enough vessels existed for some of them to be formed into escort groups that would roam the North Atlantic, ready to reinforce the escorts of convoys under attack, or even go hunting U-boats at will. A convoy could also have one or two rescue ships attached to it, to release escorts or merchant ships from the obligation of rescuing survivors from ships that had sunk. If an escorted convoy came under attack, the escort ships would attempt to find and destroy the submarine. U-boats could be located using ASDIC apparatus and attacked using depth charges, that is, bombs set to explode at preset depths underwater using pressure detonators. The escort would try to sail over the submarine and drop its charges over the stern onto the target. Later, depth charge throwers were fitted to ships that enabled them to use a wider pattern of charges. The depth charges could damage the submarine enough for it to be forced to the surface and be sunk by gunfire, or even by ramming. This latter was discouraged, as it often put the escort out of action as well, and on one occasion the ramming ship, an American destroyer, was sunk with all the crew on board. A well-aimed depth charge could sink a U-boat underwater, although the preferred effect was to explode a charge on either side of the submarine, thus crushing its hull in between. If an aircraft were to find a U-boat on the surface, it would try to force the submarine to dive and drop its depth charges just as the U-boat slid beneath the surface, when it was at its most vulnerable. Such was the success rate that Dönitz ordered U-boat commanders to remain on the surface and engage the attacking aircraft using their anti-aircraft guns. Some even managed to shoot down their assailants, but this was rare. Most U-boats lost, and Dönitz soon changed his mind. Both sides soon realized that intelligence was critical to the battle. The Allies needed to know where the U-boats were, and the Germans had to know the routes of the convoys. Both sides began with little intelligence. The Admiralty turned to the use of signals intelligence. For this, it needed an efficient intelligence gathering center and an organization that could process the information quickly and send it to where it was needed. The government code and cipher school at Bletchley Park was already using intercepts from U-boats and U-boat HQ to work out the location of enemy submarines. This information was passed to the Naval Intelligence Division's submarine tracking room, where senior commanders were advised on where and when convoys should be rerouted. The only problem was that Bletchley Park could not instantly decode information without access to the German codes and the Enigma machine, which coded and decoded the information. To solve this problem, the Admiralty encouraged Allied ships' crews to try and capture an Enigma machine. In May 1941, convoy OB-318 was attacked. 7 U-boats were involved, including U-110, commanded by Julius Lemp, the man who had sunk the Athenia. During the attack, U-110 was badly damaged and surfaced. Lemp ordered the crew to abandon the ship and scuttle the submarine. But the scuttling did not go according to plan, and the U-boat didn't sink immediately. A British boarding party from HMS Bulldog went on board and discovered that neither the Enigma machine nor its codebooks had been destroyed. When these were removed and sent to the UK, the Admiralty was overjoyed. By a clever use of subterfuge, the British also managed to convince the Germans that U-110 had sunk, taking all her secrets with her. When this information was combined with improvements in direction-finding techniques, such as high-frequency systems, HFDF, known as HFDF, it gave the British a significant advantage. But the Allies still had one problem. They needed to train people to use the technology and to interpret it. This took time. Time that the Allies did not have. There was also the temptation with the Enigma information to use it immediately to hunt U-boats. While this could have saved ships and lives, it would surely have told the Germans that the codes had been cracked. The information had to be used very carefully. Once the Allies' ability to read U-boat signals became known, the Germans added a fourth rotor to their Enigma machines. It took until the 13th of December 1942 before Bletchley Park managed to break the new system, although it was still to be some time before the Allies were confident that the information they were getting was accurate. The Germans had their equivalent in intelligence gathering, but it never quite matched the successes of the Allies. Their radio observation service, known as B-Dienst, managed to gather significant successes in the early stages of the war by using Allied radio traffic interception to identify the nature and whereabouts of Allied convoys. The Germans cracked Allied codes. This was most notable in the case of the Admiralty's naval cipher number 3, which B-Dienst broke in early 1942. This enabled the Germans to read some 80% of signals sent using this code. It was early in 1943 before the Allies realized this had happened, and a new naval cipher, number 5, was introduced. The Germans never succeeded in breaking this. The Battle of the Atlantic had begun with the sinking of the Athenia. A month later, the full potential of the U-boat was revealed. On the 13th of October, Gunter Preen in U-47 entered the naval base of Scarpa Flow in the Orkneys and sank the battleship Royal Oak while she lay at anchor. 786 British sailors died. In that first autumn of the war, German submarines also sank the aircraft carrier HMS Courageous and attacked the battleships Nelson and Rodney, and the battlecruiser Hood, pride of the Royal Navy. Yet Dönitz knew right from the start that he did not have the resources he needed to conduct an effective submarine war in the North Atlantic. By the 3rd of September 1939, he had 57 U-boats at his disposal. Not enough to be effective. He also had other problems. Hitler was initially reluctant to introduce unrestricted submarine warfare, as he feared the impact it would have amongst neutral countries. Hitler also insisted that German submarines follow the prize rules, whereby the submarine commander had to confirm that the target was a legitimate one before it could be sunk or captured. The problem with this approach was that the submarine would have to surface and make itself more vulnerable to counterattack. Dönitz was also far from convinced that the torpedoes the U-boats carried were reliable enough. This was borne out when torpedoes failed to explode or went astray, as happened when HMS Hood was attacked. But one thing his experience of the First World War had taught Dönitz was that all that mattered was tonnage. His submarines needed to sink Allied merchant ships at a greater rate than they could be replaced by new ones. If this happened, then Britain could be starved into surrender. If it didn't happen, then Britain could only be defeated by invasion. So Successes against large warships like the Royal Oak and the Courageous were excellent advertisements for the potential of the U-boat. But Dönitz argued that the real campaign should be against the merchant ships, which kept Britain fed and fueled and able to fight. Dönitz convinced his commander-in-chief, Grand Admiral Rieder, that 300 U-boats were needed to guarantee success. Hitler appreciated the argument, but stopped short of giving the U-boat force his top priority. The German army still lay at the root of Hitler's belief in victory, and Göring argued convincingly for more resources for his air force. So it was well into 1940 before Dönitz even began to receive new submarines in the numbers he needed. But this didn't stop him from beginning an aggressive campaign immediately, and once more using his World War I experience, he lost no time in introducing his Wolfpack tactics. In the meantime, the British introduced the convoy system that had turned the campaign in the Allies' favour 22 years earlier. This was largely forced on the British, who believed that the sinking of the liner Athenia heralded an early return to unrestricted submarine warfare. But the British were short of escort ships, suitable aircraft, and modern technology such as ASDIC and radar. It also took time to put the convoys together, and while the convoys were being organized, the U-boats pounced on unescorted merchant ships. British anti-submarine tactics were also confused. The Royal Navy's natural philosophy was to attack the enemy, not defend convoys. So escort groups were formed to go out and find U-boats. The British had neither the ships nor the training and experience to do this, and in the beginning even used large fleet aircraft carriers as part of these groups. The loss of HMS Courageous while on an anti-submarine patrol helped convince the Admiralty that this tactic was suicidal. The groups were also rediscovering how elusive submarines can be, as mile upon mile of ocean was examined with little success. The Royal Navy soon reverted to providing convoy escorts. So quite early in the campaign, the battle between the Wolf Pack and the convoy was joined. Dönitz's first effort was not a success, however. He had hoped to bring together 9 boats to concentrate on an attack against a convoy in October 1939. But unserviceability, enemy action, and other priorities reduced this to 3 when convoy HG3 was sighted on the 17th. Only 3 merchant ships were lost before the U-boats were forced to withdraw. Dönitz realized that his force would have to be significantly bigger if the tactic was to succeed. He released his submarines so they could return to independent operations. But by this time, he had achieved one success. He had persuaded Hitler to relax the prize rules so ships could be attacked at will. However, Hitler would still not allocate the resources Dönitz needed for his 300-boat fleet. The first phase of the Battle of the Atlantic was inconclusive. The Germans did not have enough submarines to be truly effective, and the British lacked the numbers of escorts. But both sides were active. German submarine production was increasing, although initially not fast enough to provide replacements for U-boats lost. They were also working hard to improve the reliability of their torpedoes. And the British were busy converting old warships and suitable merchant ships into escorts, as well as ordering new ones. Both sides claimed successes, but if anything, it was the British who had won the first round, by a very narrow margin. 17 U-boats had been sunk, and the convoys were getting through, mostly unscathed. This situation was not to last. The capture of the French ports following the fall of France was vital to the U-boat campaign. On the 23rd of June 1940, a convoy of trucks left Wilhelmshaven, loaded with submarine spares, weapons, and equipment. They were bound for Lorient in southern Brittany, where the first French U-boat base was being established. Shortly afterwards, Dönitz commandeered a villa in nearby Kurneval. This became his headquarters, and from here, he and his staff directed the U-boat war. Bases were also set up at Brest, Saint-Nazaire, and La Palisse. Now U-boats could sail straight into the Atlantic without the long voyage from their bases in Germany. It meant submarines were able to stay on patrol for longer, and more submarines were available at any one time. Soon, massive concrete pens were built to protect U-boats from aerial bombing while they were undergoing maintenance in port. The failure of the RAF to bomb such bases while the pens were being built was to prove a costly mistake. Using his new geographical advantages, Dönitz returned to his idea of using submarines in a pack. Six boats were placed under the command of Gunther Prien, the man who sank the Royal Oak, and five boats were assigned to Hans Rosing. The concept was good, but still there were problems of communications, and both the target convoys arrived at their destinations unscathed. Dönitz then decided to attack independent ships, and during June 1940, his U-boats sank 58 victims. Only a fifth of them were in convoy. The British were worried. By summer 1940, the fear of invasion was diverting escorts into the areas around the English Channel. This meant that convoy escorts were reduced, in some cases, to just one ship. The fall of France had also enabled German long-range bombers to attack British shipping in the southwest approaches, where a combination of U-boats and aircraft sank the liner Empress of Britain. So the British moved their convoy routes to the northwest. This, however, made them vulnerable to short-range U-boats operating from bases in Norway. The British did have one advantage, although not of their making. Continued rivalry between Dönitz and Göring meant that there were never enough German long-range aircraft available to provide reconnaissance patrols. The Luftwaffe was heavily engaged in the Battle of Britain, and Göring had little time for the Atlantic campaign, which he brushed off as merely a sideshow. Most of the cards, however, still lay with the Germans. U-boats based in France could now operate as far west as 25 degrees west. British escorts could only reach 17 degrees, and coastal commands Sunderland's could only provide cover out to 15 degrees. The British had to find an answer. One solution was to increase the number of escorts. In the long term, they could be built, but in the short term, Churchill would have to persuade Roosevelt to lend Britain 40 old destroyers. They were ill-equipped, possessed poor seakeeping qualities, and they needed to be adapted for anti-submarine operations. But they came. Throughout the autumn of 1940, the U-boats gained the upper hand. Attacking on the surface at night, they started to cause losses which the British found hard to sustain. Escort tactics were poor, and the Germans were learning quickly. Convoys were attacked at night. The U-boats would shadow by day and attack again the next night. Some very successful U-boat commanders, such as Prien and Otto Kretschmer, became household names back in Germany and were accorded the status of aces. This was very much part of Dönitz's astute public relations campaign. That is, convince the public of the U-boat's success, and the Nazi leadership will have to give the force more resources. In October 1940, convoy SC-7 left Halifax for Liverpool. It lost 17 ships out of 35. In the same month, convoy HX-79 lost 14 ships, and HX-79A lost 7. In the space of less than a week, 38 merchant ships had been sunk by U-boats. No wonder the Germans called this period the happy time. Britain responded in three ways. Escorts were released from anti-submarine duties, they were given radar, and more aircraft were provided as older bombers, replaced by newer models in Bomber Command, were released to Coastal Command. Tactically, there were changes as escorts were told not to leave the convoys unescorted as they chased contacts, often spurious, all over the seas. The convoy was never to be left unprotected. Slowly, these measures began to take effect, and there were successes for the escorts. But the reduction in losses to U-boat attack in the late 1940 was more due to submarine unserviceability and bad weather than new British tactics. To compensate for the bad weather, the U-boats moved south, where they found rich pickings in the shipping off the West African coast, where escorts were non-existent. During the winter of 1940-41, the Allies started to fight back. The big reorganization in the command and control structure, which saw the creation of new, partly unified commands and the better use of joint intelligence, started to have an impact. Losses were still happening, but proportionately they were less than in the desperate autumn of 1940. Even the aces began to encounter more resolute defenses as they attacked. In March 1942, Preen himself was lost when attacking convoy OB-293. Kretschmer surrendered after being forced to surface and scuttle U-99. A third ace, Joachim Schepke, was crushed between the bow of HMS Vanock and his own periscope as his U-boat was rammed and sunk. These losses were a serious blow to Dönitz, especially as they meant that five U-boats had been lost in 3 weeks for the exchange rate of 15 Allied merchant ships. This loss rate was unsustainable, and Dönitz was still suffering from a lack of available submarines. He decided to change tactics. In April 1941, Dönitz decided to move his 9 operational deep-sea U-boats further west to establish a patrol line at 30 degrees. This soon reaped dividends when convoy SC-26 lost 11 ships. The cost to the Germans was one U-boat. This forced the British to develop further the facilities on Iceland, particularly the airfields. Sunderlands and Hudsons were sent to the island and helped to push the protection screen further west. But the problem remained that there were not enough escorts or long-range aircraft available to provide the necessary cover. The capture of the Enigma machine offered the Allies some respite, but again it was to be some time before the full impact of the capture could be assessed and the information it released used. This and other technical advances needed time. Operators and assessors had to be trained, and experience had to be gained. However, one advantage to the British was now beginning to produce results. The increasingly obvious support for the British by the Americans had not only led to the lease of the 40 old destroyers, but also to the Americans themselves becoming more involved. As early as October 1939, the Americans had declared a security zone around the coastline of the United States. This meant that British shipping was safe from attack while in the zone. On the 10th of April 1941, President Roosevelt said that the safety zone would be moved from 60 degrees west to 26 degrees west. At the same time, he announced that British warships could be repaired and refitted in American dockyards. This blatant abuse of the neutrality rules meant that the security zone now stretched 2,300 nautical miles across the Atlantic and included the Azores. It was inevitable that U-boats would become more and more confused about where they could operate and who the enemy was, especially when American warships were seen to be escorting British convoys within the neutrality zone. Mistakes occurred. American warships were attacked, and one, the USS Reuben James, was sunk with heavy loss of life. More American merchant ships were also being attacked, usually by accident, but in some cases deliberately. Hitler had to issue a direct command to stop German U-boats targeting Americans. He was still desperately worried about provoking the United States into war. Things were getting bad for the Germans, and Dönitz was infuriated at what he saw as blatant interference by a neutral state. By the summer of 1941, he was also concerned at increasing losses amongst the German supply ships, which were maintaining and resupplying submarines in the more distant waters. These losses were the first tangible benefits of the cracking of the German codes by Bletchley Park. In June, things became even worse for the Germans, as President Roosevelt ordered American forces to occupy Iceland. Within a few months, the island had become a very well-equipped and well-defended Allied base, instead of merely being the home to a few RAF coastal command squadrons. But still, Hitler refused to react. And in August 1941, a U-boat was actually captured almost fully intact by a combination of surface escorts and RAF Coastal Command aircraft based in Iceland. Unfortunately, the crew of U-570 managed to destroy their secret equipment and documents before their ship was boarded. After being thoroughly examined, the U-boat was taken into the Royal Navy and named HMS Graf. By the end of 1941, the situation was improving significantly for the British. Dönitz was still chronically short of U-boats. Allied anti-submarine equipment and experience were improving, and the growing American involvement was having an effect. At the same time, Hitler ordered Dönitz to send his valuable submarines to support the campaigns against the Russians and in the Mediterranean. In the Mediterranean, some very visible successes were achieved. The legendary aircraft carrier Ark Royal was sunk, and the old battleship Barham was destroyed most spectacularly by U-331. But Dönitz knew that these would not win the war. The Japanese attacked the US Pacific Fleet's base at Pearl Harbor in the Hawaiian Islands on the 7th of December 1941. But the United States had been in conflict with Germany for some time before Germany officially declared war on the 11th of December. The Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Harold Stark, admitted this when he said, "We are at war," in October 1941, following the sinking of the Reuben James. Following the official declaration, however, the situation in the North Atlantic became much clearer, and Dönitz, who knew the implications of US entry, could at least recognize who the enemy was. But he realized that in the long term, American war production would be crucial to his idea of a tonnage war. He calculated that just over 800,000 tons would have to be sunk each month if his campaign was to succeed. The figures for the last 6 months of 1941 did not give him much cause for optimism. Only 120,000 was being sunk each month. At last, U-boat production was beginning to pick up. Dönitz had 91 U-boats available in January 1942. By July, this had increased to 138. This still meant he had nowhere near enough. Many boats would be in maintenance, on training duties, or still working up to operational fitness. So on the 1st of January 1942, Dönitz was only able to deploy 6 boats against the United States. This did not stop him. He began the campaign almost immediately. He called it Operation Paukenschlag, or Operation Drumbeat. He told the 6 commanders to avoid convoys and operate independently. Attempts were made to track the submarines, but bad weather and operational difficulties meant that the information available to the Allies was inconclusive. On the 12th of January, U-123 found the first victim. In all, the operation accounted for 41 merchant ships, for no German losses. It was the second happy time. The Americans, despite their already significant experience, were totally unprepared. Many of their escorts had been sent to the Pacific. The ones that remained were poorly equipped and manned by inexperienced crews. Ironically, the best anti-submarine units available were 7 US Coast Guard cutters. It was perhaps now a source of regret that many of the ships the Americans could have used had already been sent to Britain under lend-lease arrangements. Admiral King would not introduce convoys until he had the ships to escort them. This was against all the advice of the British, who had experienced similar problems themselves 2 years earlier. But King refused to accept British advice, nor did the American Eastern Sea Frontier Command have the aircraft it needed. These had been seconded to fleet protection, and in any case, many of them were under the control of the Army Air Force, with whom the Navy did not work well. To help, the British temporarily lent the Americans 10 corvettes and 24 trawlers until US forces became available. The Americans realized quickly that things would have to improve and set about producing new command and control systems to enable all the parties to work together more closely. At last, they began to learn the lessons of the British experience. They also began a huge construction program. But the U-boats continued their deadly work. They moved south into the Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico. They even surfaced and used their deck guns to shell oil installations ashore. The American reaction was poor. Even when U-boats were located, inexperienced escort crews lost them or failed to press home their attacks. On one occasion, a merchant ship opened fire on an American destroyer, believing her to be a U-boat. The destroyer's captain and 2 sailors were killed. The British tried and tried to convince Admiral King to introduce convoys, but still he refused, believing that a convoy not escorted properly would be a bigger liability than merchant ships sailing individually. The British also tried to get the Americans to shift priorities from the Pacific to the Atlantic. While this was going on, the Germans continued to exact a heavy toll off the eastern seaboard of the United States, where ships were often sunk within visual distance of the coast. No blackout had been introduced. This made spotting merchant ships much easier for the U-boats, as they were silhouetted against the lights of the cities. By March, things were beginning to improve, as new escorts began to arrive, but it was still May 1942 before the Americans began to convoy ships down the east coast and into the Gulf. Once this happened, the number of easy targets for the U-boats began to decline, and so Dönitz turned his attention back to the North Atlantic convoys and reintroduced his wolf packs. He still had to attain his required number of sinkings to keep his tonnage war on track. Despite improvements to the American anti-submarine capability, the demands of the Pacific drew more and more resources into it, leaving the Battle of the Atlantic to the British and the Canadians. A mid-ocean escort force was formed based in Newfoundland, which would take convoys straight from Newfoundland to the coast of Ireland. More new escorts were entering service, including the first of the new purpose-built super corvettes, which became known as frigates. But as new ships entered the fray, their lack of experience became critical. This was especially true in the case of the Royal Canadian Navy, that had expanded from almost nothing to provide 33% of the escort vessels in a matter of 18 months. It was not surprising that the Canadians were not as competent as they were expected to be. The convoy battle was rejoined with a new fervor, and the Atlantic War was about to reach its most critical phase. The climax of the Battle of the Atlantic was reached in the early spring of 1943. But there were already signs that the campaign was entering its most crucial phase as soon as the German U-boats rejoined the battle against the North Atlantic convoys in the summer of 1942. Admiral Pound, the First Sea Lord, realized that Dönitz would have to put almost all his effort into the North Atlantic if he was to win. At the beginning of this phase, the British were still suffering from a shortage of escorts, not helped by the dispatch of two escort groups to the United States waters. Admiral Pound's belief that this was leaving the North Atlantic too exposed seemed to be confirmed in July, when convoy ON-113 encountered a large force of U-boats. In the ensuing battle, a U-boat was sunk and the rest driven off, thanks to a well-coordinated defense. However, three merchant ships were lost. The determination and tactics of the defending forces moved Dönitz to broadcast to the German people, telling them to prepare for heavy losses. In early August, he sent a pack in to attack convoy SC-94. Two U-boats were sunk, but not before a third of the convoy had been destroyed. The Allies realized that there had to be a change of tactics. The first of these was the creation of the Escort Support Group, a squadron of fast escorts which could go to the aid of a convoy under threat. The first of them, the 20th, was commanded by Commander E.F. Johnny Walker, a name which became synonymous with the victory in the Atlantic, as did that of his flagship, the sloop HMS Starling. Like all good ideas, however, it took some time to reach fruition, and the escort groups were not to be effective for some 6 months. The continuing problem of air cover was also being addressed both by increasing the number of very long-range aircraft available and by providing ships which could carry short-range aircraft, the MAC and the escort carrier. A further change in Allied tactics, made possible by the number of long-range aircraft, was taking the battle to the enemy, attacking the submarines while they were on transit into or out of their secure bases on the west coast of France. Air-mounted radars and the Lee Light made this possible even at night. Early successes in the Battle of the Bay were encouraging. Not many U-boats were sunk, but submarine commanders realized they were vulnerable at night and so had to transit the Bay of Biscay underwater, adding to their patrol times. This also had the knock-on effect of the Germans allocating long-range Ju-88 fighters to the west of France, hoping to shoot down the Allied anti-submarine aircraft. The British reply to introduce the long-range bow fighter into the campaign proved more than a match for the Germans. The war against the convoys continued. Convoy ONS-154 sailed into a force of 20 U-boats in December 1942. 14 merchant ships were lost for one U-boat. TM-1, a tanker convoy, left Trinidad bound for Gibraltar. It lost 77% of its ships without sinking even one U-boat. These losses forced Churchill and Roosevelt to make the Battle of the Atlantic their priority. Although the torch landings in North Africa had been a success, the real victory would involve a landing in Europe. For this to be successful, vast amounts of men and munitions would have to be massed in Britain prior to the invasion. Much of these would have to come across the Atlantic, and if they were to do so successfully, disasters like ONS-154 and TM-1 had to be avoided. The appalling weather of January 1943 gave the convoys some respite from attack, but it was short. In February, SC-118 lost 13 ships at a cost to the Germans of 3 U-boats sunk and 4 badly damaged. In the same month, convoy ON-166 was attacked by 21 U-boats. 14 merchant ships were lost, 2 U-boats sunk. But the Allies were learning. The climax of the Battle of the Atlantic revolved around 4 convoys. SC-121, SC-122, HX-228 and HX-229. SC-121 was attacked by 2 packs totaling 24 submarines. The convoy's escort was weak and 13 ships were lost. As a result, HX-228, which sailed a few days later, was ordered to move south. Although it was spotted, it had a heavy escort, which included an escort carrier, USS Bogue. The battle was chaotic, but only 4 merchant ships and 1 destroyer had been sunk. 2 U-boats were also lost. The other 2 convoys, SC-122 and HX-229, were attacked almost simultaneously and suffered severe losses. They were only saved from catastrophe by the arrival of Coastal Command aircraft. But still, 22 ships were sunk for the loss of 1 U-boat. Dönitz was jubilant, and the Allies desperate. For the first time, it seemed that communications between North America and Great Britain could be severed. But actually, the lessons of these 4 convoys on deeper analysis revealed that at last the Allied effort in providing more escorts and long-range aircraft were beginning to work. The number of U-boats used was huge, and proportionately, the Allied losses were not that high. It was difficult to understand this when the North Atlantic seemed full of sinking ships, but the operational analysis teams were far from pessimistic. They believed the Allies were on the verge of success. Between the 4th and 7th of April, an attack took place against convoy HX-231. 3 ships were sunk, but 2 U-boats were destroyed and another 4 badly damaged. On the 29th of April, convoy ONS-5 ran into the largest wolf pack of the war, 40 U-boats. 1 ship was sunk that night. On the 4th of May, 6 ships were sunk. The following day, 7 more. But the U-boats were decimated. 8 were sunk and 5 very badly damaged. Dönitz called off the attack. Losses on this scale were unbearable. 2 weeks later, he tried again. On the 16th of May, convoy HX-237 made it to Liverpool, having lost just 3 merchant ships. 3 U-boats had been sunk. Convoy SC-130, whose escort was commanded by Commander Peter Gretton, who was due to get married at the end of the voyage, ran into 33 U-boats. In the ensuing battle, not 1 merchant ship was sunk, but 5 U-boats had been destroyed, 1 containing Lieutenant Peter Dönitz, the Commander-in-Chief's son. Gretton got married. At last, all the Allied assets, land, sea, air, intelligence, technology, and training had come together. The result had been the destruction of 31 U-boats in little over a month. On the 24th of May, Dönitz ordered his boats out of the North Atlantic. He assured them that this was a temporary setback. But he, like most of his crews, suspected the battle was lost. In May 1943, the U-boats were beaten. But the battle did not end, nor was it to do so until the last day of the war. But they were never to threaten the North Atlantic in the same way again. From now on, they would deploy singly and attack targets of opportunity. As such, they were constantly a threat to Allied operations and were sinking Allied ships right up until the end of the war. But the existing submarines had been outpaced by technology. By the middle of 1943, the Type 7 and 9 U-boats were no match for the combination of ships, aircraft, detection systems, and weapons the Allies were putting into service. By the time the new technology U-boats were entering the conflict in late 1944, the war was all but over. By 1944, also, many U-boats were being destroyed before they could enter service as Allied bombers attacked the shipyards. The Allies continued to hunt and destroy submarines wherever possible. But after the spring of 1943, it became a battle of aggression, not of defense. New long-range aircraft, protected by long-range fighters, took the fight deep into the Bay of Biscay. and on the 20th of June, Captain Walker took his escort group into the bay to work with the aircraft. His primary target was the supply of Milchkau submarines, which were enabling U-boats to operate in many areas away from the North Atlantic. Together, they sank two. Within a few months, almost all the Milchkaus had been destroyed. Unfortunately, Walker himself died shortly afterwards, the victim of a heart attack. Dönitz grasped at the new technologies available to him. He was particularly impressed by the NAT homing torpedo, which had some success against convoys as early as September 1943. They were particularly effective against escorts until the Allies worked out deception and decoy techniques. Dönitz continued to deploy submarines against convoys, but the loss rates were heavy and the effect decreasing. Intelligence rerouted convoys, and by October, U-boats were struggling to find targets. On the 16th of November, Dönitz withdrew the U-boats for a second time. From then until the end of the war, the German submarine became an irritant rather than a threat. In November and December 1943, 72 convoys reached their destinations without the loss of a single ship to submarine attack. American shipyards were completing new cargo ships at the rate of one a day. A 10,000-ton Liberty ship could be welded together in 10 days. One was even built in four. The first ones were unreliable and could even break in half in rough weather. The later ones brought the munitions, the fuel, the food, and the weapons that the Allies needed for the invasion of Europe.
Today, the shipyards of North America sound their answer in the clang of hammers. New ships to release British merchantmen for service in the Atlantic. And along Canada's coasts and rivers, the corvettes take the water to help Britain's hard-pressed destroyers keep that vital supply line open. Already the tide of battle may be turning. Already the wide Atlantic is becoming a graveyard for the raiders themselves. Yet the final answer lies not alone in ships. Hitler himself has said, it is not arms that decide, but the men behind them. And behind these men of Churchill's Island lies a thousand years of the sea in peace and war, in calm and storm. Because of them, the convoys plow on and Britain's lifeline holds.
The tonnage war had been lost. Within a year, the bases in France were being evacuated, and the losses of U-boats and their accompanying vessels in this operation was little better than carnage. In their last operations in the Baltic, the situation was even worse. 83 U-boats were sunk in the last 5 weeks of the war, almost all to aircraft. On the 4th of May, the second Führer of Nazi Germany, Grand Admiral Karl Dönitz, ordered all the remaining U-boats to cease operations. 3 days later, the war against Germany formally ended. The surrender was signed by Karl Dönitz. Despite the great hopes of Dönitz, the U-boats did not win the war for the Germans. There were never enough U-boats for the battle. Dönitz and Rieder had agreed that the German Navy would need 300 submarines. By the time they had that number, it was too late, and the battle was lost. The successes of the large packs, however, at the height of the campaign, demonstrated what could have been achieved if the numbers had been there. The escorts could have been completely swamped. The ability of the Allies to build new escorts and merchant ships to replace those sunk had been underestimated. The Germans might have succeeded if the Americans had stayed out of the war, but as soon as they entered and the Liberty ships came rolling down the slipways, the tonnage war was doomed. The Allies also were able to use advances in technology much more quickly. They introduced radar, new detection devices, long-range aircraft, better weapons, and better intelligence. The Third Reich built 1,162 U-boats. 830 took part in operations. 784 were lost. Of the 41,000 men who manned them, almost 26,000 were killed. 5,000, the lucky ones, were captured. 2,828 Allied and neutral merchant ships were sunk, almost 15 million tons. How many died in them will never be known. 30,000 British merchant sailors were killed in the Battle of the Atlantic. The Royal Navy lost 175 warships trying to protect them. 5,880 airmen and 2,000 Canadians died in the same cause. It was vital to the Allies that they won it. If they hadn't, Britain may not have survived to continue the war against the aggressor. Many of the battle's victims have no known grave, no headstone to commemorate their last resting place. But they cannot be forgotten.